Good morning, Discovery. It is good to be in the house together and in our homes together so that we can just continue our worship of our Lord and God and our Savior Jesus this morning. I want to read to you from Psalm 95. It says there, "Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. So come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care." It's amazing that we can get together to continue our worship of our God and just do this corporately today. We want to encourage you today that as we step into our singing style worship, our giving style worship, our hearing style worship, that you would just be blessed by the presence of God this morning. And that as we gather in our homes, as we gather in this place, we just really pray that the presence of the Lord would be an encouragement and a blessing for you and an empowerment for the week that's ahead. So let's worship together this morning.
Stand. let's lift our voices. Worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Yes, Lord, I just want to thank you that you're in this place this morning. Father, we just come before you as your church, as your bride, Lord. We come before you with everything we've carried with us in our weeks, in our months, Lord, in our years. Father, would you just help us to come to you with open hands, Lord. Pray you just give us the strength, Lord, and the confidence to place what we're carrying into your hands this morning. Yes, Lord, would you just fall upon us right now in this place? Let's sing together.
So I walk upon sound.
Thank you.
listen together day and night.
There's not much other response than that, is there? You are worthy, Lord, and all things are from you and all things go to you. And some of the other things that we've sung this morning, what can I say? What can we do but offer our heart completely to you, Lord? Father, we thank you for your presence. We thank you that we can gather here together as discovery, wherever we are, whether we're here on site or in our homes, on the podcast later, Lord, we're all gathering to bring glory and worth to your name, because only you are worthy, Lord. So we do that this morning. We thank you for the privilege of being able to bring our hearts before you, knowing that you accept each one of us, Lord, wherever we are, whatever journey we're on at the moment, you accept each one of us this morning. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Welcome to Discovery. You guys can take a seat if you're in the house. If you've been standing at home, you can sit down too. Grab your lounge chair or your favorite stool, whatever you're sitting on. It's so good to be together this morning, and we just really welcome you, each and every one of you. It's just such a privilege to have everyone here today. And whether you're online or in person, we're just so grateful that we get together today. We get to worship our God together in so many different ways. And one of the ways that we can sort of move into that space is by getting out. We have a QR code on the screen at the moment, which allows us to access things like prayer requests and the sermon notes that you're going to be able to use this morning. Matt's already put them up there, and so you're going to be able to work through those notes. It'll help you to engage more deeply with the message this morning. So if you've got your phones there and you want to jump into this QR code in our Discovery Live part of the service, that would be awesome. If you're new to Discovery, we'd love to know a bit about you, who you are, where you're from, what's drawn you to Discovery, whether you've found us online or whether you've been, you know, brought here by a friend, or whether you come here regularly. We'd love to get to know you more, and you can do that also through the Discovery Live piece. Every week in our services, we continue to do worship together with our giving, and we decide to be a generous people because we've experienced the generosity of our God in our lives in so many ways. And so each week we decide to give a part of our finance, not just as a sense of duty, but out of a sense of gratitude and a sense of knowing that we're part of a bigger plan, a bigger story that God is writing in the world today. And so as we think about that giving, let's pray for that today. Father, we thank you for the fact, Lord, that we have the capacity to be generous. We have the motivation to be generous because you've been so gracious and good to us. And so as we think about and bring our giving this morning, we just pray, Lord, that you would multiply it in ways that we would never even be able to think of, that people would be brought into the kingdom and have relationship with you, Lord Jesus, because of the generous giving of this community today. We pray it in Jesus' name. Also, on the QR code, you can actually access a section where you can put in prayer requests right now. And what we'd love to do closer to the end of the service, as we've done over the past couple of weeks, is actually bring some of those prayer requests and be able to pray for them right here this morning. So if you've got prayer requests, if you've got somebody that you know, either in your family or in your world, who needs prayer, if you need prayer for some specific situation, we'd love to be able to do that this morning, pray together as community and worship our God with our needs also, bringing them before him. As I said, the sermon notes are in for today, and we get the great privilege of having Matt Destry continue our series, The Lamb Wins, as we work through the book of Revelation, which has been really exciting. And this morning will be no different. Just wanted to let you know too that we have three giving stations at each of the exits here in the auditorium. If you want to do your giving manually, we have envelopes there. If you want to do prayer requests manually as well, you can also grab a card, write those out and put them in the box. That would be fantastic. And these are all the ways that we get to continue our worship today. And as we get to open the word again this morning, we just really pray that, that Matt would just, we just really pray for you, Matt, that you'd be blessed this morning as you bring the word, as you help us to contextualize a book that sometimes is so hard to contextualize for ourselves in our day. But this series has been super helpful, and I pray that today it will continue to be so for you. So get your notebooks and devices ready. We're going to welcome Matt to the stage in just a moment. But before that, we're going to see our sermon bumper and watch the clip for this series.
Thank you. Good morning. Hey, how are we doing today, everyone? So good to see you. So glad that you're here, whether you're joining us on site or if you're joining us online. It's a privilege and it's an honor to be able to have you join with us today. Good news, we get to open the Word of God again together this morning. And so I'm really looking forward to that. But acknowledging the fact that we are just over halfway through the year now, or towards the end of July, how's your year going? How's it going? How have you found it? We're in July. For us personally, we've had the most disruptive 6 months, more disruptive than the last probably 2 years combined, I reckon. In January, and I hurt my leg, tore my leg off. A month after that, we had to move house, which was a really good excuse to not have to pack any boxes. But moving house is like up there with, you know, one of those horrible things that you have to do. And then a month after that, we had a dear friend of ours pass away, sadly. And we've just had the most disruptive year, more disruptive than the last couple of years combined. How about you? How are you going? You know, there was that report that came out just over the last couple of weeks that one in five adults throughout lockdown had developed some kind of mental illness. And so it's just been one of those things where the last few years has been disruptive, and we thought maybe we'd get to the beginning of this year, smooth sailing, right? Life gets back to start. But then it feels like in some ways it may have even got worse. So what do we do? What do you do? There's chaos outside and there's chaos inside. Sometimes we talk about the enemy at the gates, you know, there's an enemy just outside, kind of lurking around. But sometimes the enemy's inside the walls too, right? There are external pressures that come upon us, but then there are internal pressures that develop from the inside of us and start to leak out and flow out of us. And when I think about the context of the time that the book of Revelation was written into, AD 96 or thereabouts, into these seven churches in Asia, there are some similarities to what was going on then to what's happening now. Now, of course, there were external pressures, things that were happening on the outside for the church in Asia, those seven churches that are being written to. There is this guy called Domitian who wants everyone to call him Lord and God. He's staking his claim of divinity across the entire Roman world. Caesar is saying he's killing Christians left, right, and center. People are starting to feel the heat of what it means to follow Jesus in that kind of time. And we think, oh, yeah, that's where all the pressure's coming from. No, we get in Revelation 2 and 3, the letters written to the church that's addressing issues not just outside, but inside the community. There was idolatry going on. There was all kinds of immoral behavior that was going on. A whole bunch of stuff that was happening inside the church as well as what was going on the outside. The title of today's message is this: How to Set Your World in Order. Because if there is chaos everywhere, there's got to be something we can do, or a way that we can approach life, a way that we can approach our faith that is going to bring order, that is going to set some boundaries, that's going to set our world in a way that's going to kind of limit that chaos. You might be sitting here today, you might be joining us online or on the podcast and saying, chaos is my life. That's the only way that I exist. And for some of you, you've lived in chaos for so long, to be honest, you don't know it any differently. You wouldn't even know what an ordered life felt like because chaos has become the norm. Everything being crazy, chasing your tail, not really sure which day's which, what problem's going to happen next. That can be the way that life is sometimes. And I want to be able to tell you today that there is another way to do it. There is another way to live, and there is a way of being able to set our world in order to be able to control what we can control. Now, can you control a guy called Domitian who's doing all kinds of stuff, the Caesar who's killing Christians all over the place? We can't control those external things, but the thing that we can do is plug into a bigger reality than that and set our world in order. So we see that here in Revelation 4 and 5. A lot of scripture today. That's not a that's not an apology. That's a celebration. We get to read a lot of scripture today, which is going to be a lot of fun. We're going to start in Revelation 4 at verse 1. After this, I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice, which I had heard speaking to me like a trumpet, said, come up here, I'll show you what must take place after this. Once I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne stood in heaven with one seated on the throne. And he who sat there had the appearance of jasper and carnelian, and around the throne was a rainbow that had the appearance of an emerald. Around the throne were 24 thrones, and seated on the thrones were 24 elders clothed in white garments with golden crowns on their heads. From the throne came flashes of lightning and rumblings and peals of thunder, and before the throne were seven torches of fire, which are the seven spirits of God. And before the throne there was, as it were, a sea of glass like crystal. What we have here is a look, an open look into heaven. The word revelation in the Greek means is the word apocalypse, which literally means unveiling or uncovering, or as we've said the last few weeks, simply wow. That's the word apocalypse. That's the word revelation. So this is really where the book of Revelation gets its name. This next vision from Revelation chapter 4 flows all the way through and does not end until Revelation chapter 10. It is one continuous sequence. When the angel says to him, come up here, I must show you what happens after this. He doesn't mean sometime in the future. He means after this, as in literally after the letters that he's just written. So literally just after Revelation 2 and 3. So he's taking him into a new place and unveiling something before him. Imagine in our 3D lives, you know, up and down, forward and back, sideways. Imagine if we could peel back some kind of curtain and step into a fourth dimension, into a heavenly dimension, a dimension that exists right now, but that you and I cannot see. That is exactly where John is going. That is exactly what is being opened up before him. It is as though there is a curtain or a wardrobe perhaps that gets opened up and John steps into it to see what's really going on right now. Right now in 96 AD. Christians being persecuted. John separated from his churches on a rocky island called Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. And yet, John, I want you to see something. You are living in chaos, but I want to show you what's really going on. We come into contact with ultimate reality. This phrase, I heard and I looked, happens time and time and time again throughout the book of Revelation. In Revelation chapter 1, John hears a voice like a trumpet, like a war trumpet from behind him. And remember, we talked about that when he said, I turned to look to see the voice that was speaking to me. I turned to look. In chapter 4, it happens again. He hears a voice and then he turns to see what was going on. And we're going to see it happens again in chapter 5. What this means is that there is a sound and there is a vision, and both of those things come together to make up the whole scene. Does that make sense? So sometimes he sees something different to what he hears, but both of them, when they are together, makes up the entire revelation of what God is doing at that point in time. So he hears a voice now. Come up and I'm going to show you what happens after this. And then he turns and he sees a throne. He sees a throne. And what does he see? At once I was in the Spirit, behold, a throne in heaven with one seated on the throne, and the one who sat there had the appearance of jasper and carnelian. Around the throne was a rainbow that had the appearance of an emerald. So we now encounter the throne of God, and we come into contact with what? A rainbow that's surrounding the throne. A rainbow that's surrounding the throne that reminds us of God's faithfulness, that reminds us of the flood of Noah and the way that God was faithful to him and showed mercy. We come into contact with gems and rubies that are all around the throne, reminding us of God's beauty and his royalty. We then see 24 elders. What are the 24 elders? That's so weird. Well, 12 plus 12, most commentators say that the 24 elders, 12 of them are for the 12 patriarchs in the Old Testament. 12 of them are for the new, for the 12 apostles that followed after Jesus. And you put those two together and you get a complete picture of the people of God. Not just then, but now and for all of eternity. It kind of sums up the whole people of God, you and I included. The completeness of God's people. We see that around the throne there is rumblings and thunder and peals of smoke. It takes us back to Mount Sinai, where Moses stood trembling, looking up at the mountain where he was going to meet with God and receive the law. We have these seven lamps that come up again from Revelation chapter 1, these burning lamps that represent the completeness of the Spirit of God, varied in work but united in purpose, all there around the throne. Can you imagine? Can you just imagine for a moment? This is John. He's separated from his church in the midst of deep and severe persecution, chaos all around, chaos inside, but I'm going to show you what's really going on, John. There is one seated on the throne, and this is what he sounds like. This is what he looks like. And then this funny little phrase at the end. Before the throne, there was, as it were, a sea of glass like crystal. Well, this can only mean the chaotic waters of Genesis 1. The chaotic sea that was split by God at the Exodus. The great and chaotic sea where the Leviathan lives, where if you fell into it, you would most likely die, where there is chaos and there is unknown and there is darkness and there is depth, the sea, the very sea that Jonah fell into and was going to die before he was rescued by the fish. Yeah, that sea, it is now in God's presence before his throne like glass, calm like crystal. God is calming the seas eternally. And before the throne, there is no chaos. There is only peace. And so when we enter into the throne room, into that place when heaven is unveiled before us, that is happening right now. Right now. This is a picture not into the future, but a picture into reality. What's really going on? Right now. It means that our lives are set in order when we set ourselves before the throne of God in worship. Because your life can be full of chaos, full of wildness, full of like crazy stuff going on. And then when we enter into a throne room of God and we see him, we're reminded of his faithfulness, we're reminded of his glory, of his beauty, we're reminded of his presence, reminded of the completeness of the people of God, and there is no stress, no anxiety in him. He even calms the chaos of the chaotic sea. You see, worship sets things right. G.K. Beale said, the chaotic powers of the sea have been calmed by divine sovereignty. So which brings us to something really deep and personal. It takes us to the why of our worship. The why behind our devotion. The why of our gathering together, the why of our scattering out, the why of our serving God. It makes us ask this question. Imagine there's this scene, the very throne of God with all of its brilliance and all of its beauty. The next question is, well, what's happening? What's the correct response? How do we respond to something like that? What should we do? Because if in chapter 1, John turned to see the voice that was speaking to him, and he saw the Son of Man, remember we talked about that? Golden sash around his chest, he had white hair like wool, eyes like flaming fire, sword coming out of his mouth, all of that. What did John do? He fell down as though dead. That's the appropriate response. What do we see is the appropriate response in heaven? We will read that now. So around the throne, on each side of the throne, there are four living creatures full of eyes in front and behind. The first living creature like a lion, the second living creature like an ox, the third living creature like with the face of a man, and the fourth living creature like an eagle in flight. And the four living creatures, each of them with six wings, are full of eyes all around and within, and day and night they never cease to say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." And whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who's seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who's seated on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne, saying, "Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. Why? For you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created." Guys, we worship a holy creator. We worship a holy creator. This is the worship that's happening in heaven right now. This is what's going on, right? This is what's happening. If we were to be able to open that curtain and we were going to step through it and we were going to see an unveiling or a revelation of what's going on, this is the song that they would sing. This is the song that they are singing. And it's primarily led, the worship leaders at this point are the four living creatures. Which kind of sounds freaky, right? Like you think, six wings, full of eyes, four faces. Okay, this is when we're getting into that real apocalyptic stuff. You know, like, where is it going to be zombies next? That's what we're thinking. But this is the song of the living creatures. We have the ox, which represents the domesticated animals of earth. You know, we have the face of the man. We have the flying eagle in there. We have them all. We have the lion, the king of the jungle. In early Christian traditions, some of the people took these four faces to represent the four gospels. As you know, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, as though this was the kind of the combined testimony of the Gospels, was this song, "Worthy, worthy, worthy is the Lord, worthy are you, O Lord, and God, holy, holy." But twice John tells them that they are full of eyes. And what they represent here is all of creation singing God's praise. You know, when the psalmist says that you know, the heavens declare the glory of God, that creation itself, inbuilt into creation, part of creation's programming, if you like, is to praise God. You know, creation doesn't have a choice but to worship. Creation doesn't have a choice but to worship. You see a tree? Hey, tree, how you going? The tree's like, "I just worship God because I'm built." It's in the programming of the tree to praise the one that created it. All right, I'm going to keep going. You see the stars, right? And the stars are there. They have no choice but to point to the one that created them. They are built that way. There is no star that says, "I don't want to praise God today." It's inbuilt into a star for you and I to see it and to say, "Well, there's got to be a creator that's created that." The four living creatures cry, "Holy, holy, holy," to summarize and to emphasize the creation's song about the creator. Now, what's wild about this, right? Ready? What's wild about this is that then the 24 elders, 12 from the old, 12 from the new, summarizing the complete picture of the people of God, the 24 elders join in and the song changes. They join in and the song changes. So whenever the living creatures give glory to him who's seated on the throne, the 24 elders now fall down and they worship him. They cast their crowns on the ground. So they're wearing crowns. They have a sense of royalty that's been given to them by the one that they worship. But they throw them down on the ground and then they say, "Worthy are you, O Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things." There is a why in the 24 elders' worship that is voluntary. You and I aren't pre-programmed. We have a voluntary response to God. There is a why behind our worship that separates us from the created order. Right? Stars don't have a choice. You and I do. For you created all things. We know why we worship. There is a why behind our worship, and we join and take place in the created order when we begin to sing, when we begin to worship. So what happens when you and I worship God is we take our place, we step into our original design as created things. We step into line, we come into order with the rest of the created order by also giving our worship to God. Is this making sense? Or am I just like, I don't know, I hope I'm making sense because I reckon this is pretty sweet. So we step into our rightful place as created things when we choose to give worship to God. All right. So he's a holy creator, but he's also something else. And now we do have to dip into Revelation chapter 5, and we've got to skip over a bit, but I promise you we're going to come back to it in a future week because I want to tie something else together. But we see here that we worship a holy creator, but we also worship God as something else. Let's read Revelation 5:5-10. Where am I? And one of the elders said to me, "Weep no more." It's what the elders say to me all the time. Matt, stop crying. No, one of the 24 elders said to me, "Weep no more. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has conquered so that he can open the scroll and its seven seals. And between the throne and the four living creatures and among the elders, I saw a lamb standing as though it had been slain, with seven horns and seven eyes and the seven spirits of God sent throughout the earth. And he went and took the scroll from the right hand of him who was seated on the throne. And when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the lamb, each holding a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. They sang a new song, saying, 'Worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation, and you've made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth.'" We worship not only a holy creator, but a faithful redeemer, my friends. A faithful redeemer. Also, Revelation chapter 4, the worship is about God as creator. Revelation chapter 5 is about a worship of God as redeemer. Revelation chapter 4 is centered around the throne. Revelation chapter 5 is centered around the lamb. But it begins here with, "I heard and I looked." Because John hears a voice. He's weeping because he doesn't know if there's anyone worthy to unfold the redemptive purpose of God on the earth, the plan of God in the scroll. He's crying because there's no one to open it. No one's worthy to open it. And one of the elders says to him, "Weep no more, John, because there is one. And he's the lion of the tribe of Judah." We go, "Oh, yes. The lion's coming." And we sharpen our claws. And we get ready to roar, my friends, right? The lion's coming. And then he turns and looks. And he doesn't see a lion. He sees a lamb. And not only does he see a lamb, he sees a lamb looking like it's been killed. And we've got to put the two together and see that victory and sacrifice are always entwined together. Forevermore, from this point on, you will never have one without the other. You would never have the lamb without the lion. You will never have the lamb without the lion. You'll never have the lion without the lamb. They will be together forever. Victory and sacrifice. We can hear the sound of a lion, and we turn and look, and we see a lamb. And Jesus is to us both. What does this mean? Oh, it means that some of us love Jesus as a lion. We love that part. Yeah, let's go get him. Let's kill our enemies. Let's destroy. Let's take the mountain. Let's impose our will. Let's do everything that we can. And we don't like Jesus the lamb, who volunteered, sacrificed himself for the sake of humanity. There's plenty of lion Christians out there. Lion. Some of us love Jesus the Lamb, and we're afraid of Jesus the Lion. But victory and sacrifice are always in the mix together, and that is the exact way that Jesus came to redeem you and I. It is his royalty. It is his holiness. It is his glory that means that none of us can stand before him. It's what we love. It's his transcendence. It's his hugeness. It's the way that we can tremble before him. And that's where the fear of the Lord comes from. And yet at the very same time, when we turn and look and we see a lamb who was not only willing to live as a lion, but also to sacrifice himself on behalf of you and I, that we would be able to come close enough to connect with him. And the song that these guys sing: "Worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals. For you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe, every tongue, every language, every people, every nation. You've made them a kingdom and priests, and they shall reign on the earth." Remember, guys, this is what's happening right now. This is what's really going on. This is happening in heaven in this moment. That's something that you and I can access by virtue of the one that we worship. But he took us from being slaves and turns us into sons and daughters, into servants. You've made them a kingdom and priests. We serve God's royal and redemptive purposes. This is the difference between standing on the sidelines and being on the field playing. You and I have been called to play on the field, not to watch God's redemptive purposes, but to be a part of them. He said, you've made them a kingdom and priests. You've redeemed them from every tribe and tongue all over the world. And then you've employed them, brought them into the family business to be a part of what's going on. So this is not something that you can watch. This is not something where you can sit on the side and scratch your chin and go, very interesting. That's interesting what's going on in heaven. No, you've got to be a part of it. God's saying, jump into the water, get in the mix, be part of the worship. This is what you have been created to do. God has lovingly and faithfully redeemed you and I so that we take our place in the story. We're in it now. And it's wild because the angels can't sing this part. There is a special joy that only the redeemed have, and that is that they've been redeemed. Angels who are sinless do not know the joy of redemption. They've always been with God, always been connected to God, always created to worship Him. But you and I, we know what it's like to be one twice, created and redeemed. It gives us a very, very privileged and special place in God's economy. So imagine what it means when you and I can peel back the curtain, see what's really going on, and take our place at the foot of the throne, worshiping the Lamb. Worshiping a holy creator, worshiping a faithful redeemer. And one last thing I want to mention. Verse 8, when he'd taken away the scroll, the four living creatures and 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each holding a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. Here's what's nuts. In the midst of heavenly worship, they take our prayers and spill them out before the throne, before the Lamb. Your prayers that you pray today are being spilled out like incense before the throne of God. That's what's really going on. The angels, the 24 elders, serve you and I by taking our prayers like incense in this heavenly worshipful scene and spilling them out before the Lamb. So let's pray that in this almighty heavenly scene, that the very scene that is before all things and quite literally at the center of the universe, along with all of that that we've explained, your prayers are there and so are mine. So a few questions to apply. As I join with the song of heaven right now, what might a more worshipful life look like for me? What prayer do I need to offer before the Lamb today? Do I relate to Jesus more as a lion or more as a lamb, and how can I embrace both? Where in my life do I need to embrace and align with God's order? And how is worship expressed through my life? Songs, actions, use of gifts, study, dedication, etc. See, the thing is, where the heart goes, the whole life, the rest of life follows. And in a chaotic world, when you've got chaos in your world, and so do I, there is chaos outside of you going on around you. There is chaos inside of you. And if you know yourself well enough, you'll know that there's chaos inside of you. It's all there, all around us. And it's the same with the Christians in 96 AD, the seven churches that were written to in this time. They knew that there was chaos all around. What is going to be relevant, right, to a family in 96 AD who've just seen their mom or their dad killed for their faith? When kids have just watched somebody be slaughtered in front of them because they believed in Jesus, what's going to make sense to them? The only thing that's going to make sense is, guys, I just need you to give a picture of what's actually going on in heaven right now. Because what's going on is God's on the throne and there are people worshiping all around him. The sea is calm. The chaotic sea is now calm. And there is a sense to which your prayers are being offered and spilt out before the Lamb. There's nothing else that would make sense to a life in chaos other than a beautiful vision of the throne and the Lamb. And the way that he can take our chaos and create order. Let's stand together. I like to imagine it, you know, when this is the scene that I imagine, you know, when we were singing before, you're worthy of it all. This is what I like to imagine. I imagine Romans, Revelation 4 and 5. Because this scene makes up, it sets the stage for the rest of the book of Revelation. If you don't understand this, then it's harder to be able to capture the rest of it. Whereas this becomes like the preeminent kind of backdrop, the staging for everything else that happens in this book. Up until now, it's been preliminaries. And now we meet the scene, the stage, and where everything is. We see the throne, we see the Lamb, and we see the seven lamps that are burning. And I like to imagine it because Revelation's written to our imagination. That's why it's written in an apocalyptic style. It's the science fiction style of the day to help us imagine, to take us to a different place. And I like to imagine it as I picture myself standing alongside you in the complete picture of the people of God worshiping at the throne and worshiping the Lamb. And so, Father, today, we want to thank you for this moment, this holy moment, the unveiling of the scriptures to show us what's really happening and to invite us to set our world right by a focus on you. And so our chaos, we bring it all. The internal chaos from our lives, the things that have been imposed upon us that we cannot control. And we look to you, Jesus, our faithful Redeemer. And we look to you, Father, our holy, holy, holy Creator. We take our place in the created order. We step into that place by voluntarily offering you worship. And we do so because you've made us able to by your redemption. So in terms of response, guys, I know there's so many things that we can apply tomorrow, but one thing I'd love us to apply today is that we lift our voices in adoration. That we would simply adore our God. That we would literally take our place today as we've seen heaven unveiled before us and allow God to calm the sea. Allow him, by his presence, to do that work in us. Amen. Thanks, guys.
Yes, Lord, we worship you. We worship you in this moment because you are worthy of it. We worship you in this moment because, yeah, again today, Lord, you've showed us how important it is for our hearts to be aligned with your purpose in worship. Not just in this moment, but in every moment of our day. Each day of the week, wherever we are, with who we're ever with, Lord, these moments that we get to remind ourselves to step into that alignment of worship that changes the chaos that we experience each day, that changes that chaos into order, into where it's supposed to be. And so, Father, we pray and we thank you that you hear our prayers, that you hear each of our prayers in your throne room. And there are those who've given us praise reports and prayers this morning. We're praying for people who are still struggling with physical health issues. We have a friend of this house who's had a heart attack in this week and needs quadruple bypass surgery. We have a father who's passed away. We're praying for healing for a broken arm and recovery from surgery. And someone who's struggling with addiction. We're struggling with family breakdowns. So, Father, we bring these lives before you in worship. Father, we pray that you would hear our prayers for each one of these lives who belong to you, who are loved by you. Father, we pray for your intervention in these situations, for healing for those who need it, Lord, for recovery from those who need their minds and their hearts set right in your presence again. And we praise you, Lord, for Josh, who's recovered from 6 hours of brain surgery and who's going to be recovering to full health with all expectation. Father, we thank you for your faithfulness for this young man and for the family dinner launch at the Legacy Project. Father, we thank you for the good things that we see you doing. We thank you for the good things that we experience when our lives are in alignment, when we're stepping into the bigger story that you're writing. Father, we thank you for all of these things and pray them in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Well, thank you for being with us. This has been an amazing morning, and I just want to thank you again, Matt, for allowing us to see some of that revelation and explaining how we can move forward in our faith walk, in our faith journey every day, by aligning ourselves with the purposes of God. Where do I need to do that? That's a question for me this week. Where in my life do I need to bring back into alignment with the worship of God so that I can just be an effective witness for him and the glory that he exudes? Join us. We'd love to invite you again to join us for the early morning Bible club at 6 a.m. Monday through Thursday. We're going through the book of Revelation with Matt, and it's been such a rewarding space to be able to actually delve a bit deeper into these passages of scripture, which are just so encouraging and so enlightening for us. And so, yeah, we just continue to invite you to do that. At the information center, you can also pick up a mug if you're into having coffee mugs that represent something you're involved in. We'd love to be able to get one of those for you to purchase, and that'd be a bit of fun as well. Next week, we again continue with our series, The Lamb Wins, with our senior pastor, Jodie Destry. She's going to be bringing the word next week, so that's going to be awesome. Do not miss. That will be heaps of fun. And just wanting to let you know that as we continue to worship, as we continue to bring our prayers before the Lord, we have people who will be able to pray with you today just outside our prayer room and in our prayer room. If there's something that you really need to have somebody stand beside you with and pray about, we'd love to be able to do that with you this morning. So don't leave before you do that. Our team would love to pray with you online as well. If there is any prayer needs that you have, we'd love to be able to stay online after the service and just pop those prayer needs in. We have our pastors who would be loving to be able to do that. We'd love you guys to just enjoy the day, enjoy having some coffee and chips. If you've pre-ordered coffee and chips this morning, we'd love you to go straight to the cafe and grab those. Before you have a chat, that would really help our cafe staff out heaps because they've been working hard on getting those orders out for you. But don't forget to pick up your kids. They're going to be having a great time this morning, and we'd love you to be able to go home with all of them. We don't get a lot for them on eBay anymore, so if you can take them home, that would be awesome. That would be awesome. Hey, have a great day, guys. We really want to bless you and hope you've been blessed by the service today. Have a great week. We'll see you soon.